Hey everyone, today's species spotlight is on one of the pinnacles of snake species in the reptile hobby. It's up there with the likes of the Kribos, the Indigos, and even the black-headed pythons. Today we're talking about the tiger rat snake. Now, these guys are amazing animals. They are some of the longest colubrids in the New World, i.e. the Western Hemisphere, North and South America. Now, they do vary in both range and in size and in color. To start with the size, depending on which article or Facebook bro you want to fight with today, they can vary in size anywhere from 6 to 8 feet, 9 to 12 feet, up to 14. We're going to go with, after talking to multiple actual keepers of the animals, somewhere in the 6.5 to 8 foot range, and they can get bigger, maybe in that 9 to 10 footish range. Moving right along. Now, these guys do vary quite a bit, as I said previously. Their natural range does range from southern Mexico all the way through Central America into parts of northern and central South America. And they vary in their different habitats as well. They can be found in forests, in tropical rainforest, in humid wetlands, in savannas, even in floodplains. Now, there are quite a few variations of their color. It's pretty obvious how they got their name, with that very striking black and yellow coloration. They do vary, as I said, between sometimes a really nice striking mix of those two, almost entirely yellow or almost entirely black, where they almost can be fused with Kribos, of like the unicolor and the yellow-tailed Kribos. Now, there are a debated amount of 4 to 5 different subspecies, and sometimes those are broken into the different localities, which is also sometimes classifications of the yellows and the higher blacks, i.e. that the higher yellow animals typically come from this particular range, the higher black animals typically come from this range, and a lot of times they end up being parts of the several different debated subspecies. However, I have yet to be able to find concrete, laid out evidence proof, not only in articles, but in the actual researchers themselves, of unilateral proof that they are in fact differentiated enough to be truly defined subspecies. Now, gonna get that out of the way. These guys are a real semi-arboreal species, and they are truly diurnal. They're often found times in trees, both at around, you know, waist height all the way up into the lower to middle canopy. They have also been found on the ground as well during multiple different periods of the actual daytime. So these guys are active, diurnal, observant hunters. Really, really cool. Now, obviously you can see something going on with the snake in this video. Obviously every single one of the images and videos, not images, every single one of the videos of the tiger rat snake in this video does come from my good friends at Braden Exotics. We recently had a chance to go up there and videotape some of their animals, so stay tuned for a bunch of really, really cool videos coming up with that in the near future. As well, if you also would really like to see more of this stuff, please like and subscribe if you can. Moving right along. But you can see that they are in a very defensive position. They are puffing their necks out, and you can see that really, really cool scale separation. All of the tiger rat snakes and Spilodes, which is their genus, and which it also includes the Amazon puffing snakes, do have that ability to incredibly puff up and separate their scales out. They all have very large scales, and they can separate to make themselves appear much larger. And this is, in fact, a very defensive behavior. So most of the time, tiger rat snakes really don't like being messed with. You hardly ever see one that's super amiable to handling. And so this one was doing pretty well for us after a while of mostly calming down, but still you can see it's a very distressed animal in the moment, so we tried to limit it as much as we could. Now, these guys are, again, being diurnal, active observant predators, are fairly generalistic in their hunting practices and their prey selections. Typically, younger ones seem to favor more reptiles, but do eat mammals and birds, and then as adults, based on different prey accounts and watching predation events of adults, they seem to be favoring mainly mammals and birds as the staples of their diets. Now, if we take that information and translate it into captive husbandry practices, generally that means that they have a pretty good, easy time switching over to our usual solid rodent diets of mice and rats, and sometimes other ones in there too, which is pretty good. However, that pretty much is the easiest part about keeping these guys in the hobby. So, being, again, that incredibly large colubrid, you know, up there with, like, the false water cobras and indigos, we're talking a very, very large animal that benefits not only from a very long enclosure, being semi-arboreal again, they also benefit from very tall enclosures. And also, again, being diurnal, they do benefit from full spectrum lighting, and you will definitely see marked changes in their behavior when you give them full UVA and UVB day and night cycles and exposure, which is very beneficial for them. Now, a lot of the times they are often wild caught. You very, very rarely see any of the Spilotes that are ever captive born, and you will definitely see a reflection on the price when you do come across one. So that means that a lot of the times you're dealing with the typical stuff of wild caught animals. For a very good example, this particular tiger rat snake did have to deal with what was possibly an infection. They don't know when, if it came from when it was wild or when they very first got in captivity, that had to be dealt with an abscess being continuously treated for an extended period of time. Luckily, they are very hardy, very strong, sturdy animals, so this one did manage to pull through that multiple procedures of having to deal with that very bad infection on the skin. You can barely even tell that it had one. Now, these guys, as I mentioned previously, don't really like being handled. Very obviously, this animal doesn't, and Braden Exotics are really, really great keepers that do a whole lot of work with handling with their animals. Typically, a lot of the more oddball species you've seen on our channel, like the white-lipped pythons and the blue beauties that you can see being amiably held and coming up and interacting even with me, clearly are in not too of a distressed state. But this animal definitely seems to be. So, if you want an animal that looks really pretty, but you're okay with not really handling, then maybe, hey, this is a good thing for you. They do benefit from multiple elevated hides, both that are humid and dry hides. I did see that in a bunch of different, you know, forums and different kind of collective ideas about keeping these guys, a really cool and interesting idea that has seemed to work very well for multiple people keeping these type of really, really cool large North American and South American colubrids is essentially hanging cork tubes from different points in elevation and enclosure. So if you have a 6 foot long enclosure that it's at least 6 foot high, they'll take very large cork tubes and actually hang them up right near the top, in the middle, and lower, as well as additional ones that are scattered throughout and on the ground for them to give multiple chances of not only different places to bask in the relatively high humidity and moderate basking spots, you know, in the typical high to mid 80s, that they can find and secure not only away from being tucked away in different spots, but wanting to expose themselves as well. They are very well known for cryptic basking. You don't see them too often entirely spread out and fully exposed, but they will oftentimes be perched up in one of their hides or one of their branches or, you know, elevated cork tubes, and a good portion of them is out, like their head and neck in the first quarter of them, or a very large loop coil of them will be exposed. These guys are an amazing, beautiful species to keep. However, I would probably classify them somewhere in the high advanced beginner to intermediate level, simply because of the availability of them. While they are around, usually at like reptile shows and expos, they're not incredibly expensive because they are wild caught. However, you have to deal with wild caught issues, which is a whole thing that we've talked about a number of times, so not really for the beginner person. They certainly don't really like being handling. However, once established and eating, they are generally very hardy and very easy to keep once you have a fairly good established knowledge of how to maintain humidity and temperature levels. So, hopefully you guys enjoyed today's video. Again, thank you so much for watching. Thank you, Braden Exotics, for being able to provide these animals for these really cool species videos. Now, I will say that if you stuck with me this whole time, thank you so much, first of all. But number two, it is an absolute crazy mess at the ranch right now. We have stuff going on with our dogs, with our livestock, and multiple species of snakes that are happening, as well as working with the really cool SPI ball python behavioral study, and we are very busy. I'm going to do my best to maintain our typical two-day upload schedule with the different shorts. Those are all nice and planned out through July, but in case I don't, I apologize in advance. Stick with me. Thank you so much. If you can, please like and subscribe, as mentioned previously. Hit the bell notification. Check out the full Species Spotlight playlist. There is really good information in there, and I am looking into redoing and updating some of my very early ones because there is a little bit of misinformation. Not necessarily misinformation, but much better information that I could relay across. So, again, thank you so much. Hope everyone's having a great day, and we'll check you next time.